and we have to start right on time. So it's 6:30. So here we go. I'm Marianne. I'm one of the managers here. Thank you so much for coming to our Thursday night tune-up. GB Bikes has been a proud sponsor of the Corduroy Enduro for several years now, and so it was a natural fit to make sure that Blair came out to talk about the cord when we started doing this. So we're so happy to have him here. Tom came upstairs, looked at the crowd, and said, "You don't need to introduce Blair. They all know who he is." So without further ado, Blair Sharpless.
All right, well, thanks for coming tonight. Thanks, Marianne, for inviting us, and thanks to GP for all their support over the years. Jerry and Tom have been just great for the Corduroy, and also they come up every year and set up the store up there so that they can help the riders out too, which is always a great benefit for the riders. Anyway, welcome. We're going to talk a little bit about the Corduroy, my favorite thing to talk about. And is there anyone here who hasn't ridden the Corduroy or hasn't come to the Corduroy? Well, Clayton, you've never ridden it? Wow, okay, well, that's good. There'll be a few people that might be something new to hear, but most of the faces here I recognize anyway. I'm gonna talk about a little bit about the history of the Corduroy. You may not wanna know it, but I love talking about it, so. And then we'll get into, the route, what you need to do to your bike, what bike you probably should ride. And then, we'll talk about how the scoring works, the timing works, the impound, work area, all those sort of things. And then we'll give you a little bit of an idea of what changes to the route for those of you who rode it last year, the changes that we're planning. I always have big plans, and some of them work out and some don't. So we were very fortunate last year to have a lot of new trail. We'll get started. As long as I can work this. Okay, these are the two guys that started it all. That's Ron Jackson and Don Charters. 1952 or 3, I'm not sure which year, they went to the Jack Pine in Michigan. It was a two-day enduro, and they said, well, we could do that in Ontario. So this is them up near Bancroft in 1953, laying out the very first Corduroy. It went from, this is Ron Jackson, Don Charters, 50 years later at the 50th Corduroy, still working the Corduroy. They're not laying it out anymore, but anyway, they obviously got something right. They are quite a characters. Unfortunately, neither of them are still with us, but in their memory, we have Corduroy trophies named after them. We have the Ron Jackson Sportsman Award, and we have the Don Charters Trail Cutting Award, which we give out to a volunteer who spends an unbelievable amount of time in the woods swatting black flies and clearing trail for us. So they started it all, and when it first started, as you can tell by this guy, it's pretty casual. It started in Toronto. They toured up through the back roads and all that up to the Gold Rock Lodge near Minden. They had a sauna, a bunch of beers, good meal, and they rode back the next day. But it was competitive, and this guy is my father, and he won it in 54, which was, or 55, sorry, it was the third year it ran. So anyway, that's the way it started out. For a couple of years, they even had sidecars in it back then too, but for a couple of years it ran from Toronto up to the Gold Rock and back, and then they realized that the roads were getting too easy down here and that sort of thing, so they started it from the Gold Rock and finished it there. So as you can tell, most of the pictures I have are family pictures, so you're gonna see a lot of my dad. That's my dad in both those on a, I think that's an AGS, and that's a Triumph Tiger Cub, a 200. But so it was, it was kind of a casual deal, but then guys always get serious. That's my dad there. You can see how serious he is, and the guy in the background, he's still just having a good old ride. And that's the way it is even today. There's guys who show up, want to finish, and that's their whole goal. And then there's the guys who show up who are pretty serious. We draw riders from all over North America, and there's some decent prize money now too. So right away, it became serious. Here's, again, it was a little different back then. Couple out for a ride on their motorcycles, stop to check the route sheet, make sure they're going the right way. And I guess they got a onion on a bun or something like that, says. Anyway, another sidecars.
You should bring sidecars back.
Yeah, well, we had a vintage one there last year. It's very difficult to make the course for sidecars now. But anyway, right away, because it was 2 days, it attracted a lot of American riders. And the one guy there is from Massachusetts, but quite a varied in bikes. You've got the real competitive Husqvarnas and Penton, and then you've got this, it looks like a Honda there, you know. So because it's 2 days, it was worth the drive. So the level of competition became very high very quickly. In I think it was 56 was the first time an American won it. And then it was until 1981 when the Canadians started winning it again. That's what happened. The main reason was this guy here. This is John Penton. And that's his old NSU, which he won a couple times on. He won the court on a BMW once, too. For those of you who don't know who that is, he started a brand of motorcycle called Penton's because he got tired of riding stuff like that, and he wanted a bike that was made for enduros. This guy did more for changing the whole scene, enduro scene, than anybody else ever has and ever will. He went over to Austria, and he said, I want you guys, to his moped manufacturer, I want you guys to make me a motorcycle for enduros. And he told them what he needed, because they had Sachs motors, which were a good motor. And so he started importing the Penton motorcycles. Well, they dominated enduros in the States and up here very quickly. And the company over there decided, no, in Europe, we want to sell them under our own name, which was KTM. And so he's the one who started KTM making motorcycles, which kind of, you look around here, kind of dominated. Also, he was the same guy who went to Italy and said, I need a better boot than these, because everybody was wearing lineman's boots, which were these tall lace-up boots, you know, when they went riding. Or they were wearing rubber boots. He says, I want some. So he went to a ski boot manufacturer named Alpine Star, and he told them to make boots. He called them High Point. That started the whole motocross boot thing. And then he decided he didn't like mixing castor oil with the two strokes that he was running. So he said, why can't we make a synthetic oil? So High Point synthetic oil was the first premix oil. It was synthetic. So a bit of an innovator. And his favorite event was Corduroy. Part of the reasons the Americans dominated was he also had three sons. So Jack won it five times. Yeah, or not Jack, sorry, John. And then Jeff won it once, that's one of his sons. Jack won it once. And then Tom, the third son, he won it twice. So they ended up winning it 9 times, just the Penton. So that made up for a lot of the American wins. So the only person to break that American stranglehold was, again, my dad in 66 and 67, or 67, 68. Yeah, didn't run in 69. And now he's on a bull tackle. And I heard once someone asked my dad, you know, when they were looking at the trophy, we have a trophy that has all the names of people who won it. And they said, Bill, what happened to you between 54 and 67, besides breaking his leg at Daytona, road racing? He said John Penton happened, you know, so he was second an awful lot. So anyway, and then what do I got next? So that's the last year my dad rode on the Can-Am, which was that was 1973, first year Can-Am was made. And they have a long history at the Corduroy too. But that was the last year that he rode it. And it was also the first year that, I went to the Corduroy along with my sister, Tony, who's here. Put up your hand, Tony. Oh, and I didn't say, if anybody has any questions about anything as we go along, ask them, okay? So, because I'll forget to answer it later, or forget what I was talking about.
How many people back in that era would line up?
I went back, because when we started to get big numbers again at the Corduroy, I went back, and the most they ever had in the 70s was 350. And so we've broken that record now for a couple of years. So, but it took a long time to get back to there. At the lowest point, well, when it started off, there was like 25, 30 guys. But at the lowest point in recent history, it was 84. That was like 16 years ago. And the group that's putting it on now, we started 15 years ago. It was 84 the year before, and we changed some rules, changed the layout a bit, and every year we've been doing the right things. I've got an incredible group of people who helped me with the event. So.
Blair, you should also mention the history on Sonic on
that. Well, that was my dad's shop, the Sonic on top of the Can-Am. So when Can-Ams came out, they were a Bombardier snowmobile dealer. And so they said, yeah, I want to sell these bikes. And so in In 73, my dad rode for the Can-Am team going to Massachusetts at the 6 days. Can-Am put a big team in, and he was one of the riders there. But he, partially, I guess, because of the injuries over the years, he got arthritis really badly, and he couldn't hang on to the bike anymore. So that was the last year he raced the Corduroy. But it meant that that year we all went up, and we went around and gassed him with my mom. But he had the electronics go on the bike first day. So the second day, he got a new electric box on it, and he went out and pre-rode. And he liked that, liked working on the event. And he figured, I'm old enough now. And so from then on, that's what started my love of the thing. We went up there as a family. We'd run a checkpoint. And then Tony and Todd and I would head into the trail on our mini bikes, sweep the trail, right? Which sweeping, for those of you who haven't ridden, after all the riders go through, we send the sweepers through to pull out any riders who haven't made it and pull the arrows down. And so this, my dad would always ask the organizers for a checkpoint where my mom could drive the truck around to the other end, because I was 12, Tony was 13, and Todd was only 11. And we were riding, Todd and I were on both Tackle 100 mini trials bikes, and Tony was on an XR75, I think at the time, a Honda. And we would go into the trail, and we'd come on some guy with a broken bike, and he'd look at us and he says, hey, can you go get help? And I said, no, we are the help, you know? So I pulled bikes out with my little 100 Boltaco, you know? And the guy was kind of ashamed, so. But he wasn't gonna let the girl pull me, so, you know? But anyway, so that was the start of the family thing. And from then on, I mean, I looked forward, I don't know what it is about being up in that part of Ontario in the fall. I love it. I looked forward to it. It was always a family thing. And I started counting my birthdays until someone said, well, how old are you, Blair? Three more corduroys than I can ride. Two more corduroys than I can ride. My birthday was in November, too, so it was after the cord. But that was an advantage, because when I finally could ride, I was almost 17, so I could be competitive. But this is my first corduroy. You can see I'm pretty serious. Tony's looking like, oh, how long till I'm stuck in some mud hole, you know? Tony wasn't into enduros then. But that she found road, in case you don't know my sister, she found road racing later on in life. And she became world-renowned road racer. So, but getting stuck in the mud wasn't too good. And true to form, this is Deer Lodge. We went out Deer Lodge, went down the road, we crossed over the highway into a hydro line, and went up the hydro line. There was a big mud hole. Tony got stuck there, and she was done for the day there. She got buried so deep. And so I had a little better first corduroy. That's me leaving on the start of day two, turning the choke off, and my dad, that's him in his midlife crisis with his afro and his goatee, that's him handing my trophy, because I won the junior class, so it was pretty good. So the family tradition continued. This is near the end of when I stopped riding it, but beside me is Glenn Buchanan, a young rider from Toronto, who he ended up winning the corduroy twice later on, but very good rider. But it was always a great event in the fall to get together and race. And here, this was sort of the capping of the whole family tradition here. That's my brother Todd, my sister Tony, me, and that's even my dad filming us on the start of the corduroy. So we had the whole family out. And Tony, I think that year, won the 125 junior class. She never raced against girls. She always raced against men, because I don't know why. She was too good to back then. But nowadays, the women's pro class is amazing how fast they are. And Todd, actually, he won his class at the corduroy, too. So they're both, Todd was the dirt tracker, Tony was the road racer, and I was the mud guy. So, but anyway, that was the family deal. So not to be left out of the history of the cord was the women at the cord. There's been 1968, this was Lucy Stratton, first woman to ever ride the corduroy. She rode it on a 200 tire cub, and she finished. But the lady who really, sorry, was question? Okay. The lady who really made a name for herself for the cord is this lady here. That's Kathy Campbell from New England. And she came up and she won the ladies' class 10 times in a row. Actually, some of those she was top lady, but she didn't even ride the women's class. She started riding in the expert lightweight class, and she won it 1 year too. So she was a very fast, very tough rider, and she came up. And then this is our ladies' class last year. Right here is all the women who finished the pro class, and that podium up there is from the final motocross. And the family tradition is continuing, because this one's my daughter Megan, and that's my daughter Emma, Emma unfortunately broke her hand, so she couldn't ride, but they both been riding the corduroy since they were 16. And believe it or not, and they worked on checkpoints before that and swept trails. So it's just the full circle is happening. So anyway, that's sort of the history of the corduroy up till now. This is what the corduroy looks like now. For those of you who haven't been there, it's grown a little. This is the community center, and then we've taken over the lumberyard too. This is our demo course, and this picture was obviously taken, looks like Sunday morning, because all the bikes are in the impound, all lined up waiting for the riders. We start, the week actually isn't just 2 days of Enduro anymore, it starts on Thursday with the demo rides, and we have a lot of the manufacturers involved, and we're hoping that we'll have even more there. Last year we had KTM, GasGas, Husqvarna, Kawasaki, Beta, Yamaha, and we had a couple of the electric bicycles. We've even included them now in the demo rides. How many people here went and bought a motorcycle because of the demo rides you did last year at the Cord? Yeah, so it works, eh? That's good. We'll make sure that, did Tom see that? Yeah. Tom, did you see that? I asked how many people bought a motorcycle because of a demo ride, and with three people just in this group from the corduroy. So you can tell your factory reps. We got to get Honda there this year. Yeah. So there we are. So yeah, like I was saying, this year too, on the Friday, so Thursday we start the demo rides, and then on the Friday we have an electric bike enduro now, and e-mountain bike enduro, all added into the vintage. Because of the rich history of the corduroy, we started a vintage ride on the Fridays of quite a few years back, and it's a real popular thing, especially with guys my age who rode the corduroy when they're younger. They don't want to come out and let me put them into the woods working, but they want to be part of the corduroy, so this is a great way to do it, you know, just come up and ride the vintage. Vintage course is shorter, it's only like 50K, and so if you have a bike that's 87 and older, you can ride vintage on Friday, and then you can ride the Cord on Saturday and Sunday. This is what the start ramp looks like at the corridor right now. Everybody's up on the platform. This is 2021. We now put six on a row. We have another spot here. You can see all these plates, in case you haven't been to an enduro and you don't understand how that works. Everybody on row one who leaves on the first minute after 9 o'clock, they'll have a one on their bike. And then there'll be a letter to differentiate who they are, but that one tells them what row they're on. And also you'll notice all these plates are red. At the corduroy, we have basically four different routes. Most of the time you're all following the same route, but we have the red route, we have an orange route, we have a blue route, and we have a green route. And that's the different skill levels, because we don't want to put, you'll see some of the pictures of some of the obstacles later on, and we don't want to put the green group into those obstacles because no one would finish. The nowadays, like back when the thing started, even when I was riding it, the very best riders were held back by the motorcycle. You could only go so fast before you crash. The suspension wasn't like it is now. The bikes are so good now that the top riders can go twice the speed of a novice rider, where that wasn't the case way back when. When I first started riding, we all rode the same course. And but now we have to have different courses for the different skill levels because the motorcycles are so good that those top riders can exploit the abilities of the motorcycle. So we use the different colored number plates. So when they get to the course split, we'll have someone standing there. We see a red plate coming. Okay, you're following. And we use different color arrows. Red plates follow the pink arrows. Sort of matches the number plate. The orange plates follow orange. Everybody follows orange unless there's a different choice. And then we have the green group. I don't have a blue arrow here, sorry. But anyway, that's the way it works at the splits. So, and this is back, looks like 80s to me by the bikes, but this is why the corduroy is called the corduroy. When they first started laying it out back there, Don and Ron, northern Ontario, anywhere in the back roads, anywhere where it was low and muddy, they laid logs across. It was called a corduroy road. And this goes way back even in the 1800s when what was it, General Peterson made the Peterson Trail because they were afraid the Americans would get them, you know, so they needed an inland trail, and they made corduroy roads. And so we still do this anytime we get to a mud hole, we got to get across, and we don't want to bury all the bikes. We'll make a corduroy bridge, or we'll just lay it in the mud and make a corduroy road. Nowadays, we try to, in some of the spots, put chain link fence on it because anybody who's ridden across wet logs knows they're very slippery. And after a few riders go across, all the bark's gone. So that's the reason why it's called the corduroy. This, anybody who's ridden it will recognize, this is the Burnt River. This is back in 1986. That looks like Burt Branzy for any OCMC riders, old members. I think they'll recognize that. To me, that looks like him. But anyway, and the bike looks like an 86. But you look at, this is the Burnt River. It's exactly the same as it was when I first rode the Enduro in 78. It's still the same. And every year we still have someone go straight across and the water's this deep. And if you go around, like you're gonna come down the hill. So people haven't ridden it before. You're gonna come down the hill to the Burnt River and you go to the left and there's rocks along and you can see the rocks sticking out of the water. And you go over and you make like a crescent shape and go to the other side. And as long as you do that and you don't hit a rock and tip over because you can't reach the ground, you'll get across the river no problem. And it's not in a time section. So I always tell anybody, if you're not sure, get off your bike and walk across. You got all the time in the world, you know, because if you hit a rock and you can't reach the ground because your wheel's up on a rock, you're going to tip over and you water your bike out. And the gas stops right after it. So we've had several occasions where, like I remember one year, Jared Jonker, who was one of the top riders, he watered out here, dewatered his bike and got going and didn't lose any time because the gas stops right afterwards. Gas stops you get 15 minutes at, for anybody who hasn't ridden it. And then last year, I think Owen McKill from BC did the same thing and got the water out. So yeah, this is, I think that's Burnt River again, yeah. Yeah. This year, we're going to be crossing the Irondale River. My brother-in-law and I were out scouting last year and we've got a brand new trail and we crossed the Irondale River, which used to be those old pictures of my dad in the river. That was the Irondale. We haven't been across it in years. Last year we went across it once, but we had to build a bridge because where we were crossing it, it was too deep and too fast. So I rode across when I was pre-running with my sweepers to show them the course. And one of the sweepers who's in seam challenged, I call it, he tipped over in it. And the long legs are good in enduros. Not so good for motocross, they get in the way, but in enduros they're good. So anyway, if you haven't been to the Corduroy, it's probably the only place in Ontario where you'll find logs, rocks, swamps, mud, sand, you'll find everything. So, and as things have gone on, everybody wants to ride hard enduros. A lot of times, depending on if it's a expert section, we'll put obstacles in or leave the obstacles, where if it's an easier trail, you know, where the green group is riding, we'll cut all the logs out, sort of thing. In this picture, it's kind of notable. This guy here, that's Matt Spiegelmeyer. He's won the Corduroy three times. He's from Pennsylvania. How many times has he ridden the cord, Mike? Is it 35?
36.
36 times in a row. He hasn't missed a year, ever. So he kind of likes the Corduroy. He makes the trip up every year. What's that?
2020 doesn't count.
Well, yeah. Yeah, the Corduroy has only been 2 years since 53. It didn't run. Once in 69 because Ron Jackson got promoted to head engineer at De Havilland building airplanes and he just didn't have time. And then the other year was COVID, 2020. So otherwise it's been pretty good that way. So yeah, and then we got obstacles like this. This is the waterfall. This is a trail we put together a few years back. I think the first time we ran it was 19. And then since that we've gone down it so we can put all the classes through and not just the experts. We still put the blue and green around, sorry, but we put the orange through. But I think in 2022 we're not going to use the waterfall because I've got a bunch of 2023, yes, yeah. We've got a bunch of other trail we're going to use instead. This trail is completely on crown so you can go ride it anytime you want. For the Corduroy we like to have stuff that you can only ride for the Corduroy too. Can't make it all like that, but it's great having all these private landowners who make it happen. That's waterfall again. It's going up. But this guy here helping everybody, that's David Knight, five-time world champion. He came over to ride the Corduroy, but then he broke his back 6 weeks before the cord.
So you made him help out?
Yeah. So he came out, he says, well, I can't race, but I can ride. So I got to go riding with David Knight the week of the event, you know, just going checking out trails and stuff. And I passed him once, but, you know, he broke his back 6 weeks earlier. So, but I still passed him.
On the Friday. Right?
What's that?
You rode the vintage.
Yeah, that's right. He did.
And I got to say, I got to beat him on vintage.
Yeah, we put him on this 185 XL Honda. The muffler fell off it and he still was just like this. Anyways, yeah, super guy. Unfortunately he couldn't ride, but he really loved the cord. Hopefully we'll be able to get him back to ride it, but that's him there. Looking at the waterfall. We've been very fortunate to to get a lot of good riders to come to the Corduroy. Cord's been won by the tally now between U.S. and Canadian, because last year it was won by Russell Bobbitt. So I think the Americans are one up on us again. Mike knows it. The Americans are one up on Canadians now. I think 33-32 or something like that wins. But then we've also had a New Zealander, an Australian, an Englishman. Yeah, win it. So it's we've had some guys come over. This is Connor Brogan coming down the backside of greens. This is a good way of showing you that motocross suspension doesn't work. For anybody who hasn't ridden the Corduroy, you need to ride it on. If you're going to ride a motocross bike, you have to take the suspension and get it done completely for enduros. Not just put a softer spring on or anything. It won't work on this kind of terrain. You'll just beat yourself up. Last year there was a good motocrosser came out and ride it that I've known for years, and he rode his 450 motocrosser. And he finished Saturday, because he's a pretty good rider. He finished Saturday and he didn't go out on Sunday. He says, no, I'm going to kill myself, he said. And he says, next year I'm coming on the right bike. So he's, but that's the thing. So you got to, that's one of the things you got to make sure you have. If you're thinking about buying a motorcycle, make sure you get something that works in the woods. You know, you don't have to go get the suspension redone if you buy the proper bike. It'll work, you know, unless you're top pro. The stock suspension on any of the enduro bikes work well enough to do well at the cordon finish. So Connor, he finished second overall, I think 2019. Yeah, I think that's what it was. So this is probably 2019. Looks like he's in a hurry. So this doesn't look very steep. If anybody's walked up it to spectate, it's very steep. There's points going up this hill where you're going to use your hands to walk. And these guys come down and they actually get on the throttle at certain points when they're going down. There's been some really bad wipeouts right about here, coming down the hill, scary. This is the other side of greens. This is the three steps. And this is why, if you're going to ride the Corduroy, you have, probably everybody's heard, but you have to have a gummy tire. There's a big difference. You can, if you haven't felt one before, they're a lot softer. If you don't have one of these, like even if you're not trying to win, without one of these, your chance of finishing goes way down. It just, you get through everything so much easier. And the other secret is you got to have a mousse, because you can run lower tire pressure. It's just a foam insert. If you haven't seen one before, you don't run air. You run the foam insert. It's more expensive than a tube, but I mean, if you want to just save it for the rock events like the Corduroy, you could probably get 2 or 3 years out of it if you take it out of the tire afterwards. But with those two, see, because it's like a lot lower tire pressure too. If you put the right mousse in the right tire, you're running about 6 or 8 pounds. So it gets traction everywhere. And the illustration of that, I think I got it coming up here. So there, yeah, that's the three sisters. The guy falling over there, that's the other thing too. If you don't run full hand guards, like aluminum ones. I know a lot of the guys, like this guy here, they think all the flags are better, you know, because all the hard enduro riders ride flags. Well, that's just the little plastic things. They look like a flag. They don't do anything. They're made for motocross for roost. When you fall over, they don't do anything. When you hit a tree, they don't do anything. My daughter actually on Friday doing demo rides at the Cord last year on one of the, because the bikes don't come with these on them. She hit a tree, broke her hand, surgery, had to miss the Corduroy, that's the worst part. And the reason the flags, like so, because all these hard drill, because they're from Europe. In Europe, they don't do these because FIM doesn't like them. I remember going to 6 days with these on my bike, and what are these? You can't do that, you know? So if they grew up here, the hard drill riders, and they weren't looking at the Europeans, I'm sure they'd have these on. You fall over, you don't break your levers, you don't do any damage. And make sure you buy a good set. Don't buy plastic ones. Don't buy, like the best ones, I actually did a test about 15 years ago on all the handguards. We had a sledgehammer hooked to the ceiling, we swung it, we dropped the bikes the same. These ones won the test, Enduro Engineering. They also come under another name, I think Moose's Markets Enduro Engineering too. So, but make sure you buy good ones. They have to be all aluminum, none of this adjustable stuff that loosens up, and you check them at every gas stop, because you hit trees, you fall down, check all the nuts and bolts every gas stop, and then they won't fall off. And put these on too. Keeps some of the spray off your hands when you're going through the puddles, and it keeps some of the branches from whipping your hands too. That's the impound there, Saturday night. Oh, I guess my demonstration on the gummy tire is a little later. For anybody who hasn't been there, you finish day one now, and you got to put your bike in the impound overnight. You come into the finish, and there's a checkpoint. And then from that checkpoint to the checkpoint going into the impound, you have 15 minutes. So in that 15 minutes, the first thing you want to do is put gas in your bike. Because in the morning, you don't want to be hauling a gas can over here to fill up your bike. And then you start checking your bike over, see if you need to put a new filter in. So don't go to the Corduroy with just one filter. Make sure you buy another filter, have it oiled, ready in a bag to go. And then start checking your bike. Check all the nuts and bolts, check your chain, check everything. Walk around it, you know, and this is what I got in the habit of it from going to 6 days, is at the gas stops, you never leave your motorcycle. While you're eating, you walk around your motorcycle, you're kicking mud off, you're looking at your motorcycle. You got to ride 2 days. It's not like a normal, I'm going for a trail ride and then, you know, I'll fix it and next weekend I go riding again. You got to make the bike last 2 days. So you're always looking at your motorcycle, you're always checking things. Every gas stop, don't lose sight, just walk around your bike. Even if you got to put on some dry clothes or whatever, keep an eye on your bike, always looking at it, knocking mud off. Check the fenders aren't coming loose, stuff isn't coming loose. You can catch it before it falls off. You can tighten the bolt up. It's no big issue, right? So at night you have 15 minutes before you get in the impound. So do everything you can. Make sure you didn't put all your gas cans on the gas trucks. You make sure you keep a gas can at your truck so when you come back, if the gas truck isn't back, you can put some gas in your bike. Otherwise, in the morning, you're carrying a gas can all the way over there and then your gas can's sitting there after you've left and what's on the gas truck, right? So the best thing is come with 3 gas cans and make sure they're only 10-liter cans. If you want to bring a big one to leave at your truck, fine, but the ones that go on the gas truck, if you don't have your own gas crew, we don't want 20-liter cans. Try lifting 500 20-liter cans off the trailer and on the trailer. That's what, and they're volunteers doing this, okay? So gas it up, get it all ready, and then roll up to the impound, put it in the impound. When you get to the entrance of the impound, there'll be another set of flip cards. That's the way we do the timing. I'll explain that later. We'll get into that. We'll go through the slides here. You, yeah. What's that?
A dummy tire?
No, with someone who's not on the gas, you'll need 2 tires, or turn it around. Some of the tires you can turn around. Now some of the tires are directionals, the gummies, they have an arrow on them, but I've turned them around, they work. So, but to turn it around, you got to be pretty good at tire changing. So the best thing to do is have another wheel. So if you don't have a spare wheel or a spare bike, maybe you got a buddy who isn't going to ride the Corduroy, who's got the same bike, and you don't want to ride on his wheel and wreck his stuff, but at least you can put his wheel in, wheel your bike into the impound with it, change the tire on your own wheel, and put the wheel back in the morning, because the change of wheel takes no time at all, right? So that's what the easy way to do it. My daughters are lucky because my wheel fits, and so does my wife's bike. So we have spare wheels, so we just put a new one in, and then we burn off the other side of the tire at some other event. But yeah, 2 tires is a real bonus if you can, 2 wheels. But anyway, yeah, so, I mean, if you're in the money to go to the Corduroy and you want to do your best, then come prepared, you know. Before you get there, don't go with half-worn brake pads. Put new ones in. The half-worn ones, you can use them up out trail riding or going to a one-day event. Put in new brake pads, front and rear. Check, make sure your wheel bearings are good. If your chain is almost done, but you could get, oh, I could get the cord out. No, put the new chain on. And then when you wear that set, your chain and sprockets out, then that one that has some more life in it, throw it back on for your trail rides and your one-day rides and stuff like that. Because, you know, why create the headache for yourself? And the cord isn't like, last year, day one was 187 kilometers. When do you go out trail riding and do 187 kilometers? And it's 187 kilometers in mud and everything like that. So it's like riding probably 3 of your normal trail ride days in one day. So it's definitely worth preparing your bike for that. That's Sunday morning, right before the start on Sunday. These are all top pros. They're all prepared. That's Cheney, he's won it twice. That's Bobbitt from Georgia, he won it last year. And Goujon here from Quebec, he is the fastest man in Quebec right now. He won the final motocross, but you can see they're all prepared, just doing final little adjustments in the work area in the morning. You don't want to be doing this in the work area in the morning, okay? It's changing your tire. That's why you want to have all that heavy duty work done at night. And the 15 minutes in the morning, you're just sort of rubbing the dew off the bike or the frost and you're ready to go. Because you can't go to your truck. You push the bike into this work area and no one's allowed to touch your bike in the work area except for you. They can put gas in it and oil in it and air in the tires. but they can't touch the bike. They can't do any work whatsoever. It's like the 6 days. We try to make it like if one of these riders maybe decides someday to go 6 days, at least they've, and it adds that element to the event and makes it different. So you don't really want to be doing any heavy duty work in the morning if you can avoid it. So you got your 15 minutes and then you have to push your bike out and put it back on the starting ramp. And then when your minute comes up, so for these guys, when number one flips, off they go again. So it's a
cold start.
Yeah, cold yeah, start on Sunday.
A certain amount of ways.
Yes, yes. Oh, did I go two there?
Yeah.
Yeah, sorry. Wasn't watching. So just so on day two, this is the Devil's Staircase in the Blackberry Trail. It's kind of a neat section. And again, this is where your gummy tire and your all the protection. I don't run a lot of protection, but I have the equipment to blow pipes out at my garage. So, but if you don't, maybe a pipe protector is a good idea. A decent skid plate's a good idea. Tristan Hart, he won it in 2021. Everybody knows him now. He's a world-class hard enduro rider. Unfortunately, he couldn't come last year because the world or the U.S. Enduro Cross Championship was the same day. So, but every year he says he wants to come, and hopefully this year it doesn't. Again, another classic rock corduroy section. This is Brian Wojanowski. He rode last year. He won it twice before, and then he's gone away. He should be winning the vet expert class, but he still last year rode in the pro class. And even, I don't know how old he is now, but I think on day two, he was third overall or something like that last year. So he still goes pretty good. He'd been riding trials. That's what he went and did. So here's the tunnel, the infamous tunnel. I got a lot of complaints from the pros last year about the tunnel shouldn't be timed because there was a big bottleneck. So this year it's not going to be timed. So since it's not timed, I might send more riders through it then. Because we'll see. But anyway, it's as you can see, it's quite a spectator point.
Remember the year we couldn't do it?
Yeah.
You could drive a Sea-Doo down there.
Yeah.
Coming out like.
Yeah. Yeah. You see where it's coming? The water was up to here.
It
was just after COVID, the first one after COVID.
2021, so it was 2021, yeah. Yeah, the water was up to here, so we decided to cut the section out. We didn't think too many would make it through. There's inside the tunnel. It's really slippery rock all the way along, so it's, like I say, right now we only send the red plates through, so unless you're running pro or vet expert or expert, you don't have to do this. And that's what I was saying about how we divide things up, you know, because if we send everybody through there, it would just, most people would just turn around and go back and say, okay, I'm done, you know. These are the best guys, and they're having trouble. So here's my my gummy tire thing. So this is Guy Giroux. He just got inducted into the Canadian Motorcycle Hall of Fame. He's won everything there is to win off-road, except he's never come to the corduroy. He was always a cross-country guy. He hated keeping time. But now we don't keep time at the corduroy. At least you're allowed to be early. He came out to the corduroy, and I was talking to him. He raced back when I was racing, so I know him. And I was talking to him, and I said, so Guy, I looked at his bike. I said, Guy, you don't have a gummy on there. He says, oh, this is good. This is an intermediate tire. I said, you need a gummy tire, Guy. So anyway, here's why you need a gummy tire. That's Guy swimming, because he got on the ramp, so he was perfectly positioned, everything, his tire just spun. And so his buddies with Philip Cheney, and Cheney gave him a wheel at the end of, or a tire, sorry, he's on a Sherco, gave him a tire, and the next day he said, you know, it was like Eureka sort of thing, you know, so again, the gummy works. Final motocross. Up there is probably the only place we can, in one trail, you can have sand, you can have rocks, you can have mud, you can have river crossings, logs, everything. So it's a great place to go riding. But anyway, here we got a couple guys battling it out on the final motocross test, which after everybody's finished, you get to watch the pros go. I don't think too many of the other people really want to ride a final motocross after riding 300K or so. So we just have them come and watch the pros go at it. And last year we added the pro women did a final moto too. And here is that Kirsten? Anyway, pushing someone out of her way here as she's going through. So, and this is what most of the people do it for. This is at the finish of the second day, you're getting your finisher's medal. So, 90% of the people who come to the corduroy come to get their finishing medal. And then that 10% are trying to get their trophy. And It's the people who have them, it means something, but it's just a chunk of wood. That's all, but it says what you did. So anybody who knows what they are, it means something to them. And to these guys, obviously there's a bunch of money too. That's Evan Smith, he won in 2019. So $5,000 to the winner. So as far as enduros go, it's probably about the best paying one going. And then the women also get paid at the Corduroy too. That's Shelby Turner. If you haven't heard about her, she's, I don't know, five-time U.S. Enduro Cross champion, but she's an Alberta girl, Canadian. And so, again, she couldn't come last year because of the Enduro Cross Series. But the women are becoming a bigger and bigger part. I think we had almost 30 women all together at the Cord last year. Anyway, that's Cheney. Due to the hard work of Mike and Michelle Bell and Jim Botten, who are all here today, who do all our AV stuff. And this is the voice of motorcycling, the voice of the Cord now, Pat Gonzalez. So try to make it look a little more professional and sound professional. And here's Pat interviewing Cheney. He's a great guy, great ambassador for our sport. This is some of the work that Mike does, putting the videos together, and you know, that we put out and that sort of thing. I think you've all seen them online. Another video there. So now, as far as how the events run, so most of you have been there, but we've got a few people who haven't. So it's a check to check, which means that if you lose time in one of the test sections, you start off on number 10. And you get to the end of the first test, and you're now late, and you get to the start of the second test, there's another set of flip cards which show your number on it. And number, you came out late, so you're now number 15 showing when you get to the start of that next check. You don't have to worry. You're not losing 5 minutes for being 5 minutes late because you're now on number 15. You start that test whenever you want. We don't count any time you lose in the transit sections, which are the sections between the tests. We don't want you racing on the road. Sometimes the only thing between the tests is road, gravel road and that sort of thing. Sometimes it's trail. Some of the transit sections are difficult and you'll lose time. But it's not a race in the transit sections. That's the big part about with the Cord is learning to conserve your energy, go fast when you need to in the tests, but don't go crazy in the transit sections and break your bike, fall down, or wear yourself out. So, because it doesn't matter how late. The only thing that matters as far as lateness goes is if you are over an hour late behind your original schedule. So our number 10 guy, he starts number 10 in the morning. If he gets to a check later on in the day and he comes in on number 71, he's 61 minutes late. He's DNF. So that's the only time it matters. So if you start to drop a lot of time, you have your gas stops, which give you 15 minutes, get into the gas stop, fuel up, get what you need and get out, and you can get 10 minutes back probably, you know. And then down the roads, if you speed, you're gonna get caught, but you can do 50 kilometers an hour. The speed average that we set the schedule with at the highest is 36. Most times, if it's in the trail, it's only 24 kilometers an hour. So as long as you go down the roads at a decent pace, and don't waste time, you're gonna, you know, get some time back. And I always tell people, you never stop to do anything until you get to the checkpoint, you have those flip cards in front of you and you know you have time. So you come out of the one test, don't mess around doing all sorts of stuff. Get moving, get to the start of the next test where there's the next set of flip cards, and you're number 10, you get there, oh, five's up, oh, I got 5 minutes. Now I can mess around with my bike because my brake wasn't exactly where I wanted or whatever. I'm gonna wipe the mud off my goggles or whatever I'm going to do. Don't do any stopping until you know how late you are. Now some people will take the route sheet, which we give you. There's one here. This is last year's. And they'll take the times for the tests and they'll write it out on a cheat sheet and put it on their bike somewhere. I know my daughters do. My one daughter, she doesn't really care about the time. She wants to know how long the tests are so she can conserve her energy. My other daughter wants to know what time they start at so she's keeping time, you know. But whatever works for you, put it on a piece of duct tape and just put it on your tank or on your handlebar. And that way you have a clue of what's going on and what's to come. You know, and you can see, okay, look, I've already dropped 45 minutes, oh, but the gas stops next. I'm gonna get some back, so I'm gonna push and see how things are after that and see if I get some time back. So the route sheet's got a lot of useful information. when you roll up to the checkpoint, if you are early, don't block the entrance to the checkpoint because there's probably some person who's had a problem or whatever, they're gonna be late coming in. So stay to the side. when you're number 10 guy, when number 9 is showing, he's on his bike, he's got his goggles on, everything's running, he rolls up when number 9 leave into the test, and then he will get scanned. It's all electronic. We have a little sticker on your helmet, visor on the side, and you just get scanned for the start, and then the person with the flip cards will count you down, go 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, go, and that's when you take off. And that's how it works. And then at the end of it, there's just a camera that catches your tag. You just ride right through, and then stop a little ways past, make sure they got your number. You know, they'll usually tell you to go, and then you're good. And that's how it all works. And we add up the test times from every test. On Saturday, there's like 8, I think, and there'll probably be 8 on Sunday the next year too, both days. We give you a map. We've got a bigger one up here. This is last year's. We're going to be making some changes. In my little scouting session last fall, my brother-in-law and I, we found a new trail to connect us from here over to the toe jam test. And that was a new test last year, and it's not called toe jam because I stubbed my toe in it. It's my sister Tony and her husband Jamie. That's what toe jam is. So it's the toe jam ranch. So anyway, this year it's going to be even longer. Last year it was 15K about, but it should be longer this year because we can use some new stuff now. And then after that, we'll either be going up to Wilberforce to go to Bill's Hills, or we may just be coming around here. But then I've got another that Jamie and I found. We've got another brand new trail that goes here and goes back down and connects to here. And then this test here, McDuff's, will be 5K, probably add another 3 or 4K into it. And then this one here, if we get it cleaned up, McCrum's last year, we had a brand new 6 kilometer section added, which we only ran the pros through. But we should, if it's cleaned up now, I don't like to run everybody through the new trails the first year, because up there, you don't know if they're gonna fall apart. So if we only put the pros in, they can handle it, right? The pros and the experts. So now that we've run it for a year, we'll probably be able to put everybody through it, and that'll make that test 9.5K. So, and then you'll come back down through this new trail, back down here, and then do McDuff's. So on the first loop, if I go up to Wilberforce, the first loop will be 100K. if not, it'll only be 72 or so. And then, so there'll be a gas out here, probably put a gas in Torrey Hill, and then we'll gas back at the start, and then we'll do the same thing we did this year. At the start, if you're more than half an hour behind your original time, you're gonna be done, because that way you don't go out and do the second loop. but this year it's longer, so we're gonna do that again. The only reason we do it here is because you're back at the start. So, I mean, I'd love to do it at the first gas instead, like we did last year. But what do you do then? You trailer or ride down the road? You can't do that, right? So that's why we do it at the start. So you'll be going out, and it'll either, like I say, we'll be going up to Bill's Hills if I find a good route up there. I've been doing some scouting over the last couple of years. And this trail we have connecting this, I may not be able to make it work. We have 3 swamps that we have to build stuff across. So anyway, if you want to help, you just send me an email and we'll let you know. And then after that, we'll be going out. And I'm thinking too, is if I run the 100K, or even if I run the 70K, I may be stopping the green group there. All the green group may stop there, because the afternoon will be Greens Mountain, and then the butt test and weigh camps, and then back to the finish. So the afternoon loop's gonna be fairly short. So, but I'm thinking if, because this morning loop's gonna be, we'll just stop the green there, and then you'll just impound your bikes whenever you feel like it, and put them in, and then Sunday's course is going to be very similar to, if not almost identical, except for a few changes to the trails themselves, as this year's Sunday. Sunday worked out really well, the timing, the spectator points, everything like that, and I think there's a few changes I want to make. Like, hopefully we'll be able to, I've got a route through Miserable Lake that we'll be able to run. Sunday will be a long day. It'll have Task Force, Scott and Sue's, Miserable Lake, Sedgwick's, Blackberry, Somerville, and then Big Baldy, and then the final motocross. So it'll be a long day too, a lot of tests. Does anybody have any questions about the scoring or timing?
Where's the new river you're talking about?
The Irondale River? It won't even be a test. It's going to be a long transit. It's going to beat the crap out of you, though. It's It goes from.
It's not solid.
Yeah, it's right here, right here. So we were like, I was told that the hunters own the sawmill that we park in, and they also know everybody. And so the more time I spend up there, the more I get to know everybody now. And the landowners, so anyway, they're telling me about this guy who's all upset because the logging road, the skidder road off the end of Tamarack Road, they got pushed all the way in, and they were showing me on a map where they pushed it all the way in. I said, oh, really? Because, you know, we trying to find a way over to the Toe Jam Ranch. I want two ways over. Last year I had some two-way traffic here on Hadlington Road. I wanted to get rid of that. So they said, well, this is pushed all the way in here. And you know, if you come down there, he's got a cabin there, and he's really upset though with the loggers, you know, and that sort of thing and everything. So anyway, in the fall, I ride in that skidder road, and yeah, it goes all the way to almost to the Irondale River, and then it's all slashed and we couldn't get through. So we marked on the GPS. We go around the other side and we start down this road, and it's a dirt road, and we can tell someone's in there. Jamie and I are riding along. It's really beaten in. We get there, and there's a guy. He comes out of the cabin. He's got an axe in his hand. And I'm going, okay. I get off my bike, take my helmet off, go, hi, I'm Blair. I organized the Corduroy Enduro. You know, and he goes, oh, I went and watched it. His little grandson's with me. I went and watched that race over in Goodrum. And he says, you know, you should be coming right across the river right here. And this is the guy I thought I was going to have trouble with. So we're going through there. So it's good. And that's what makes the event happen is and which makes it, you know, I think a novelty to come ride is because when you come up there and you go riding, you can ride all the Crown stuff, but, you know, you can't ride all these projects. So when you come ride the Corduroy, you get to see stuff you can only see once a year. So we got some stuff up here. If you want to take some stickers and stuff like that. Is there any other questions? Yes?
I'd like to know a little bit about the trail ride.
The trail ride. I don't run the trail ride. The trail ride's run by Rally Connects, and he runs it on Saturday, and then he does a dual sport ride on Sunday. And basically what he'll run on Saturday is our Sunday enduro course, but he'll just have options out. And some of the trails, because the private landowner doesn't want us going through 2 days in a row, so he doesn't get to use them. But other than that, ride at your own pace. It's a great way to check out the Corduroy and then maybe the next year ride it, that sort of thing. I think there's someone here who said they rode the trail ride and next year they're...
I've ridden the trail ride.
Oh, yeah, but you've ridden the cord.
Because I couldn't commit to a weekend, so it was one day of great fun.
And
it was just fun.
Yeah. But I think was this... You rode the trail ride, didn't it? Wasn't it you?
Yeah, it was me.
Yeah, now you're going to ride the cord.
Yeah, I can get the time off. So.
Oh, okay, good. So yeah, the trail rides, like I say, it's a great way to introduce yourself. But you know, if you come out and ride ladies novice, it's a shorter course, an easier course, and you know maybe you only get one day. But you know,
quick question about the trail.
Yeah.
Vintage survive the trail?
Well, the best thing to do with your vintage bike is to ride the Friday.
Yeah, I just wondered.
Yeah, no, we've had, there's a couple guys from Quebec who ride the whole thing on their vintage bike. They like riding it, you know, that sort of thing. So
tires as well?
Or? Oh, it works, you know. I mean, if you're riding vintage, you know, like it would depend on what class, like, you know, because we class you by the rider. So if you're an expert rider, but you're on an old bike, you're still riding expert.
I would not be an expert.
Okay, so you can ride it. As long as the bike is, you know, mechanically sound, we don't do a tech inspection, we do a sound test. You need to have a green plate or a blue plate on your motorcycle to ride the event, and you have to be 16 years old because you have to be, you know, the Highway Traffic Act allows an exemption for green plates on the road, but you have to be 16 and have a driver's license, car license, sure. Motorcycle, doesn't matter.
Full license?
It could be a learner's permit. Yeah, but
not me, my kid.
Yeah. Okay, I'm thinking, how'd you get here? Yeah. How'd you get through life to this point?
I start this Sunday at 8 o'clock this year, or 9 o'clock.
I'm going to go with 8 o'clock. It worked out well because our sweepers are back, and you know, and we got the trophies out. A lot of people want to hit the road, and you're already there. Everybody's there. You know, I could see starting Saturday at 8 would be a problem for some people, but Sunday you're there.
I know it's a little dark first thing in the morning at 8 o'clock.
Yeah, it gets you used to with the 6 days, you know. Well, you must have been riding too early a number then. Sign in later, you know.
No.
That's the other thing, too. If you notice on the bottom of these signs, not that one. May 17th, that's when registration opens at 12 noon.
Again?
So anybody who knows how this goes, usually by 1 o'clock, we're up to row 50 or something like that. So if you want to have a nice early number, and of course we put all the pros and experts and vet experts at the front because they have to ride the extra trail, and we want to get them back early enough to get them for the final motocross. So unfortunately we put the best riders up front on the best trail. They don't like it because they don't want to be breaking trail. They want a trail that's beaten in, but it just, for the logistics of the event, we kind of have to do it. So the first number available, unless you're riding one of those three classes, is going to be like 26, row 26. So it's a good idea to be all signed into live laps and ready to hit enter right at 12 o'clock in 1 second, and then you'll get maybe you'll get row 26.
Is Saturday going to be a longer K this year than last year? Or are you talking about extra trails?
Right now, the way I have it laid out, it's 132.5. So it's a little shorter, but there's less road. Like the first loop last year, there was more road than there will be now. If I go up to Wilberforce, it'll be about 180, about the same as this year. Yeah.
We're not going to do that big loop around Miserable Lake this year.
Yeah. Sunday's remaining pretty well the same. Just the tests are going to be the same tests. I'm just going to be making changes to the tests, but just make them all a little better and that sort of thing. The gas stop in the Kinmount Fairgrounds worked out because last year we outgrew the gas stop we were using over in Somerville Forest, and that's the other thing. I guess we didn't touch on gas crews. If you haven't been there. The best setup is to have your own gas crew, someone who's taking care of you. So they come up and they're not riding, and they take your gas can and your spare gloves and your spare goggles and everything, and they take it around to the gas stops. We give instructions to them where to be at what time and that sort of thing. And that way you have someone taking care of you and you can have all your stuff. If you can't talk someone into doing that for you, well then you rely on the gas trucks we have, where we'll have a trailer where you put your gas can on. You can attach a small bag to the gas can with a snack maybe, or a spare pair of gloves and goggles, whatever you want, but it better be attached well, because these gas cans are all piled in this open trailer on top of each other, because there's a lot of gas cans, and then you have no one helping you. The gas can will be there, but that's it. So it's a lot better to, I'm lucky I have a friend who comes up, and because I'm too busy and gas is for my daughters, he's their own personal mechanic, so they feel like they're factory racers.
Greens is on day one?
Greens is day one, yeah. Greens is the first test after gas two. We'll be coming back to the impound, gas up, and then you'll go to Greens. So, and then and Greens will be like it is the last couple of years, where we split and only the red plates go up and over and up and over again, and then, but you're all going to go out, and if my Ian Peters here is the man who takes care of Greens Mountain for me, so.
Last year we came out of the waterfall trail, came on back on the Butts property, and then hooked the left to go to Greens.
Yeah, you didn't, what class were you riding?
Vet A.
Okay, so yeah, you didn't ride weight caps.
No.
That's another thing. That was a brand new test for us last year, so I only ran the red plates in there because there was some hills I didn't know how they'd hold up. And so see how that looks this year. So everybody may be going through weight camps this year too, which was, it was a lot of fun. It was a great trail. It's like 5K long, perfect length, doesn't get you tired. And at the end of it was fast too, so it was fun. So hopefully we'll be able to get everybody running through there this year.
Lee has a question for you.
Yeah.
Any words of wisdom for somebody that wants to do this for the first time?
Yeah.
So, is there a place to go and get a read up on everything so they get?
Our website has a lot of information on it.
Right.
I mean, the program that Mike and Michelle put together, I think this one's 2 years old, but in there's a lot of information. Yeah, well, this one, you can take a copy of these, but online is the most current one, and there's some articles too. Last year, get over here, where last year, the guy Bruce Moffat, who helps out, he wrote a couple articles on like what to put in your tool bag, what to do at the gas stops, what to do at the work area, and they were really good. I gave him some ideas, and he already had an idea, because he's ridden the event quite a bit. And so read those. They're a great source of information. But yeah, if you go online, there's put Corduroy Enduro in, plus all the videos. Mike has been making videos now since 17?
14.
14. Holy cow. So there's a lot of video on there that shows you a lot of the terrain, you know? And so you get a good idea. And the other thing is a lot of it is crowned. So you can go up there, you can ride the waterfall trail. We didn't use it last year, but Fast Eddie's, you can ride Somerville Forest. That's a great spot to park and ride. And it's a lot of sand there, but there is some rock and stuff like that if you get down into it. And then a couple river crossings and stuff like that. But there's a lot of public land you can go ride up there. You can practice all year. That's the one advantage. Owen McKill, he's coming back for revenge this year. And I think he'll be there on the Monday because he's going to probably go out and walk every test because he's got to get it, because he says the Ontario boys have an advantage on him, you know. And Cheney, he's been riding this event for I don't know how many years now, so he knows every trail unless I give him a new one. But last year, the new one, the Toe Jam, he won it by a minute or so. Brand new trail, no one had been on it. The only ones who had ridden it was me and Tony and Jamie. That was about it. So, but anyway, yeah. So some of the guys will be there, you know, to walk the trails the week of. Within 2 weeks of the event, you can't ride any of the trails up there. You can ride the trails, but you can't ride the tests. And since you don't know what is test and what's not, and if we happen to be out there arrowing and you're there and we see you signed in for the event, then sorry, you can't ride it. You become a worker then, and I'll get you working very hard. So,
are you going to do the Conquer the Cord workshop again for folks?
I don't know. It all depends on this guy here, Sean. We did this Conquer the Cord last year with a little bit of riding, showed some of the trails, and basically a lot of similar talk I'm just doing tonight. And CORMA, Corth Off-Road Motorcycle Association, they came up with this idea. They put it together, and the proceeds from it, they were donating to the six-day team. But anyway, yeah, we also, on the Saturday night, we're bringing back the tire change contest, which is a lot of fun. Hopefully we'll have the six-day team there, most of the riders will be there. And we you can wager on what you think the fastest time will be. And so, you know, right from, you know, 10 seconds all the way up to 2 minutes or whatever. And if the fastest time of the night is the one you put your name beside for $20, then you get 50% of the purse. It's a 50-50, but they would do it that way. And then the money goes to the six-day team. 6 days next year, or this year, is in Argentina in November. And we're hoping to send a strong team again. So, but a lot of those riders will be at the Corduroy, if not all of them. And so we'll get them there to, and I guess while I'm at it, keep your eyes open for, we'll be doing a raffle again to support the six-day team. Where it's $100 a ticket, but there'll be two motorcycles. So there's two first prizes, two motorcycles, and then there's gear and graphics kits and a bunch of other prizes too. So, and that's all to raise money for the six-day team. Yeah.
Question, on the scoring. If you time out on Saturday, do you out for the weekend?
No, you can ride Sunday. But you're probably not going to finish. But you can ride Sunday. You won't get a finisher's medal because you didn't finish both days. But yeah, for sure. You know, get your bike all ready. All we ask is if you're going to ride on Sunday, make sure your bike is in the impound by 5 o'clock before we chain it up. And we have a security guard there. The security guard is there all night to make sure your bikes are safe. But if you're not sure about that, bring a lock to the impound and lock your bike up to the impound. Yeah.
I think you mentioned it, but the color-coded tracks, are they completely separate or are they intersect?
No, the trail, most of the time, yeah, I didn't go through just for those, all the arrows. So I didn't go through, most of the time you'll just be following orange arrow. It's like your default arrow. But any time there's a different color, if it's your color, you follow that color. So you may see this, right? But if you're not in the red group, you're following orange. You follow this, and I would say for the green group and the blue group, you're going to follow this 90 to 80% of the time. The red turns off a few times, and then and the only time the blue and the green don't run it won't be a test. You'll be going a different way and missing a test is what happens. And then just for those who haven't ridden an enduro before, that means wrong way. That means you missed a corner. So a little ways past the corner, you'll see a W. And so, you know, you have to turn around and go back. You'll find the trail. When you turn around, make sure you're very careful because if you missed it, someone else will miss it. And that's when we always, and before you turn around, take a look over your shoulder because there'll be another guy coming barreling past too, right? So, like I was saying at the start too, we have test sections and transit sections. And just so you know, in case you missed the scoring antenna and the people standing there and all that at the end of the test, then you'll be on these arrows now. Those are transit arrows, they're not race arrows. So if you see these arrows, you trail ride to your next test. This style of arrow is what we use in the tests. And then this is what we use at road crossings. Now, if the person arrowing doesn't have X's in their arrow bag, they may just put arrows pointing down at a road crossing. But also, this means in the trail, there's something ahead that you may not see, and the speed you're going, this will give you a little bit of warning, to slow down because you can't see it. So that's just what we call a caution arrow. And if you see a lot of arrows down, it means slow down a lot. If you only see one, it means maybe you want to go down one gear, just roll off for a second and see it, But coming up to checkpoints, we'll have some of these, so to slow down, because we put a chicane at the end of the section to slow you down so the camera catches your tag properly. But other than, yeah.
Time for one more.
Look at the time. Okay.
If you're new to riding.
Yes.
But you've done quite a bit of riding, every weekend kind of thing.
Yeah.
How do you know kind of what class is?
I get this question a lot.
That's
where do you ride?
Five Points Trail.
Okay, so the terrain.
Yeah.
And that sort of thing. I always tell everybody that if you've never done any racing whatsoever, and you've never ridden an enduro or anything like that, sign up in the lowest class.
Okay.
But if you're a pro motocrosser, you're not gonna, I know you know how to ride a motorcycle, you're not used to the terrain, so if you don't want to ride pro, at least ride expert, sort of thing. But if you have never done any racing whatsoever, whether enduro, motocross, or anything like that, then sign up in the novice C or vet C. That's the other thing too, if some of you have been paying attention to if you're already Off-Road Ontario members, the events run under Off-Road Ontario rules and sanctioning. And this year they've changed the class a little bit. They've eliminated the Vet C class and they put a plus 50 class in instead. So now we have Vet Expert, Vet A, Vet B, those are all 40 years and plus, and now we have a plus 50 and a plus 55 instead of the Vet C. At the Corduroy, because of the varied terrain and stuff like that, I'm still going to run the Vet C class. So if you want, it's not an official OO class, so there won't be any points or anything, but I'm going to have, three trophies just like any other class, because I feel there's a lot of riders who that would suit them better than, just because you become 50 doesn't mean you get faster. So the plus 50 class is going to be fast guys, just like the plus 55. The guys who win it were pro riders when they were in their 30s and 40s. So, and also the novice C class has been eliminated. I'm going to run it just so we have a place for people who have never ridden before. At the OO runs mostly cross countries, and at the cross countries, the class changes maybe make a little sense, but for the enduro, I think I really need those entry level classes where I can cut people out of trails. So I'll still have four groups. I'll have my green, my blue, my orange, and my red groups. So, but they won't be points paying. But if you're just coming out to ride the cord and you're not riding any other old stuff, you don't care about points and provincial championships, then sign up in the class that suits you best. Okay, I see Marianne here, so I guess I have to stop talking.
I'm just here for whenever you finish.
Oh, yeah. Well, I think she's going to do her draw. Did everybody fill out a card?
Yeah.
To win the prizes?
Oh,
well, fill out a card before the draw happens.
Can we unveil this?
Oh, yeah.
Anybody wondering who's behind the map?
Oh, he might be here.
Sean Robichaud will be signing autographs.
I can still white to your eyes there.
I'm about to hit a tree.
That is on the wall in Toe Jam, which last year this ranch that my sister and her husband own is an old homestead farm from the 1800s, where for generations they picked rocks out of the field and they put them in a straight row to make a fence, and so we rode along the top of the fence with the, and so everybody remembers the section quite well who had to do it. So it was a great section. Okay. Yeah, sure.
All right, so you're finished. Well, thanks so much, Blair.
Yeah, well, thanks everyone for coming out.